The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, short and succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. And at question number one, I'll allow a moment. At question number one, I call Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the Mental Welfare Commission's report, Ending Exclusion, Care, Treatment and Support for People with Mental Ill Health and Problem Substance Misuse in Scotland.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by reaffirming the commitment from myself and from the Minister for Drugs Policy, Angela Constance, and the rest of the Scottish Government to saving and improving lives of people living with poor mental health and addiction. I fully support the position Ms Constance recently set out in the Chamber that every drug death is one too many and this remains a public health emergency. I'd also like to thank the Mental Welfare Commission for producing this timely report. We will, of course, carefully consider its findings in detail over the coming weeks. The Commission has made clear our focus must be on delivery. Members will be aware through the National Drugs Mission and our work across mental health, there is a significant amount of activity underway to deliver more effective and joined up care for people with co-concurring mental health and substance use. This includes work led by Health Improvement Scotland to create better working links between substance use and mental health services, the ongoing rapid review of mental health and assistance and substance use services, the implementation of the medicated assisted treatment standards, alongside the development and the implementation of standards for adult secondary mental health services.
Claire Baker.
I thank the Minister for that reply. The Mental Welfare Commission report is damning. It talks about little or no out-of-hour support for people, a lack of trauma-informed care, people rejected access to mental health services due to their addiction, and services being understaffed and underfunded. And one service user said that people felt abandoned by a broken system. And another said, "I just want to see change. All I see is people dying or being forgotten about." But the delivery of MAT standards 6 to 10, which is central to addressing mental health and addiction, has been extended with an implementation date of 2025. That is 3 years later than what was originally promised. So following the statement from the Drugs Minister in June, can I ask the Minister if the senior leaders have been appointed across Scotland and how the Minister will work with the Drugs Policy Minister to drive forward delivery of MAT standards 6 to 10, which are central to mental health, and ensure they are not neglected, as the focus will be on 1 to 5, which have to be delivered by next year?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, let me make it quite clear to the Chamber that both the Minister for Drugs Policy and I believe that mental health and substance use services must be joined at the hip. And we have been clear on MAT standards that we want to see all of the standards fully embedded as soon as possible. And the progress made to date has not been good enough or quick enough as far as we are concerned. And at the end of the last parliamentary session, the Minister for Drugs Policy wrote a letter of direction to all territorial health boards, integration authorities and local authorities. This directed that by the end of September, chief officers and chief executives must personally sign specific and timed improvement plans for implementing those MAT standards. And the Minister for Drugs Policy will update Parliament further on the progress of those standards in December.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, all of this activity, which I do recognise is taking place, does require investment. And while the Drugs Death Task Force acknowledged recent funding commitments, it said they didn't go far enough to deliver transformational change. They described the funding as woefully inadequate. So while the Drugs Minister does lead on policy in this area, it is, as the mental health ministers recognise, partly his responsibility, because many of the MAT standards focus on the relationship between drug services and mental health. So is he confident that the £10 million a year for the implementation of the MAT standards is enough, given concerns that have been raised around the risk of staff burnout?
Minister.
Thank you very much, and I welcome the opportunity to answer that question. We are supporting the delivery of the standards with that £10 million a year for the next 4 years, as Ms Baker rightly highlights. But there is more than that going on. And we, I and the Drugs Policy Minister are jointly funding Health Improvement Scotland with funding of over £2 million to improve pathways between mental health and substance use services. And HIS will work directly with local partners to ensure people are receiving person-centred care. But let me go beyond that, because it is my expectation and Ms Constance's expectation, Presiding Officer, that we use existing expenditure at Health Board level, at IJB level, at local authority level, to get this absolutely right. This is a joint project between all spheres of government here in order to get this right for people. And what we will do is ensure that that investment is made properly. And beyond that, we all need to work together to change cultures. And that's why the HIS work is so important in that regard too.
Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, I know from conversations with police officers in the North East that they are often the stand-in for other services when someone is in crisis out of hours. This is starkly reflected in the Mental Welfare Commission's report, which quotes officers as saying the police and ambulance service are the constant fallback for other services when neither are the appropriate services to offer meaningful assistance beyond an assessment at A&E. What immediate steps is the Scottish Government taking to ensure that people in crisis can be swiftly and reliably referred to the right help and interventions out of hours? Thank you.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, crisis interventions are one of the areas that are being looked at by the Drugs Task Force. But beyond that, we have on-the-ground support at this moment. Take, for example, distress brief intervention. And Ms White mentions the northeast of Scotland. In my own city of Aberdeen, the distress brief intervention project there is dealing with people in crisis on a day-to-day basis. And talking to police officers in my own patch, that is making a real difference in taking pressure off of them. Beyond that, the member may well be aware, Presiding Officer, of the pilots that we have going on with the Scottish Ambulance Service, including in Dundee in the northeast of Scotland, where there is quick interventions for people who have mental health crisis. So these things are already happening in many parts of the country, and I'm quite happy for Ms White to write to me or to Ms Constance, and we can update her on all of the actions that are happening in the northeast corner of our country.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're all aware that getting people into treatment and recovery that is right for them at the right time is at the core of the national mission to save and improve lives, and residential rehabilitation is one of a wide range of options. Can the Minister provide an update on plans to expand access to residential rehabilitation placements? And I remind Chamber I'm co-convener of the Mental Health Cross-Party Group.
Minister.
I welcome that question from Emma Harper, Presiding Officer. Over the course of this Parliament, we are working to increase the overall residential rehabilitation capacity from 425 beds to 650 beds, and for 1,000 people to receive statutory funding for their stay in residential rehabilitation. The Government has committed over £23 million in funding for the development of projects at the Phoenix Futures, River Garden, NHS Lothian and Aberlour. Investment in the four projects combined will provide a total increase of 85 beds by 25-26, boosting the current rehab capacity in Scotland from 425 to 510 beds. In addition, We have been working with alcohol and drug partnerships to aid the development of clear pathways into residential rehabilitation. The results of this can be seen in Public Health Scotland's most recent interim report, published on the 27th of September, which found that 218 statutory funded residential rehab placements had been approved across Scotland between April and June of this year, an increase of 85 from the previous quarter.
Thank you. Question number two, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it expects to meet air quality limit values in light of the recent report from Environmental Standards Scotland.
Minister Marie McCallum.
Presiding Officer, current data indicate that EU limit and target values have been achieved across Scotland for all air quality pollutants, with the exception of 6 locations for nitrogen dioxide, 3 in North Lanarkshire, 2 in Glasgow and 1 in Edinburgh. The most recent assessment projections estimate that all of these, bar 1 location in North Lanarkshire, will be compliant during 2022, and that remaining North Lanarkshire location will follow in 2023.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The report highlighted that monitoring guidance might not provide a comprehensive picture of air quality in our cities, especially around areas with vulnerable people, such as schools and hospitals. So does the Minister agree with me that we should install air quality monitors at every Scottish school?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Member for the question. I just want to briefly say, before moving on to the specifics, that I very much welcome the report from Environmental Standards Scotland. Indeed, I welcome that we were able, with a great deal of work, including by my predecessor, Rosanna Cunningham, and Scottish Government officials, to make sure that Environmental Standards Scotland was set up and that there was no governance gap as a result of EU exit. I am statutorily obliged to respond to the report, and that within 6 months, and I will do that. I'm not going to preempt the response to any of that today, including on the specific point that the member raises, although I think it's a good one. I will bring it back to the Parliament, but I want to be clear today that I absolutely welcome the recommendations, and I'm committed to working with ESS to progress them.
Maurice Golden.
The report concludes current attempts to improve air quality aren't enough, that the system contains significant weaknesses and that areas of non-compliance will likely remain. Now, I understand from the Minister's answer that the Government will make a formal response to the report, but can the Minister at least give us an assurance that these failures will be recognised so that progress can be made?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, our ambition is for Scotland to have the best air quality in the EU, in Europe. So I absolutely, whilst working very hard with Scottish Government officials and across with our stakeholders across civic society, we are driving forward progress. We are always alive to where improvements need to be made, including those highlighted by Environmental Standards Scotland. But I do think that it's important to note that we have seen over recent decades a significant reduction in pollution. This has been because of improved fuel quality, cleaner vehicles, and an increased focus on sustainable transport. Indeed, between 2005 and 2019, which is the year for which we have the most recent statistics, nitrogen oxide emissions have decreased by 53%, fine particulate matter by 30%, and sulphur dioxide by 85%. But as I say, we're not complacent, and we will continue to work through the Clean Air for Scotland 2 strategy and on the recommendations of ESS in continuing to improve that.
Natalie Dawn.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Could the Minister give an indication of how the level of air quality in Scotland compares to the rest of the UK and other parts of Europe, and how the Scottish Government will deliver on its commitment to further improve air quality here in Scotland?
Minister.
Compared to the rest of the UK, Presiding Officer, and indeed other parts of Europe, Scotland enjoys a very high level of air quality. Targets are being met across the vast majority of Scotland, and levels of main air pollutants have declined significantly over the last 3 decades, some of those which I pulled out in my previous answer. Of course, the introduction of low emission zones in our 4 largest cities as of May this year is a key initiative in further improving urban air quality, and we have committed to investing at least £320 million, or 10% of the total active travel budget by 2024-25, and that's almost triple what it is today.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. Well, electric vehicles do impact on air pollution through brake and tyre dust, so we need fewer cars, not just cleaner cars. AVs don't emit NO2, so are part of the solution in improving air quality. The Climate Change Committee estimates we'll need at least 30,000 public EV charging points in Scotland by 2030, but the government's target is just over 4,000 in the next few years. With only 395 public charging points installed last year, when does the Minister think Scotland will reach the 30,000 public EV points that we desperately need in Scotland?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I should allow my colleague, the Transport Minister, to respond directly on questions of transport and indeed charging infrastructure as it relates to that. But having said that, part of the Cleaner Air for Scotland 2 strategy is about bringing together, recognising that air quality is a multifaceted issue which requires to work across government. So I am working closely with the Transport Minister as well as with planning and health colleagues. But I think it's I suppose what I'm saying is I'll have to come back to the member with an estimation of when the rollout of EV infrastructure will be where he thinks it ought to be. But I would draw the Chamber's attention to two key provisions for transport as they are linked to air quality. Firstly, our commitment to reduce the car kilometres driven by 20% by 2030, and indeed to phase out new petrol and diesel vehicles by the same date. Both of those will have a significant impact on air quality in Scotland.
Mark Ruskell.
Lung conditions are the third leading cause of death in the UK, with over 2,500 premature deaths per year attributed to air pollution alone in Scotland. So in that context, could I ask the Minister what action the Scottish Government is taking to ensure that local authorities are required to deliver robust and up-to-date air quality action plans with specified target dates?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I am in no doubt, and the Scottish Government is in no doubt, that air pollution and physical health are very much connected, with the very young, older adults, and with those with underlying health conditions being most impacted. However, the relationship is complex. It's widely accepted that pollution has a negative impact on health, but we also know that the types of illnesses that air pollution exacerbates are also impacted by other factors like smoking. However, on the member's point directly, we've committed under our air quality strategy, Cleaner Air for Scotland 2, to develop that more systematic approach to action plan production and implementation, including a standardised format and a methodology for both agreeing and setting defined timescales for completing individual measures and revoking air quality management areas and reporting progress. We will also commission a review of air quality data collection and reporting in Scotland to identify any notable gaps in data provision, with recommendations on how to fill these. And again, this is all part of Cleaner Air for Scotland 2, which we're currently progressing.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.